Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Climate Restoration, the Only Future That Will Sustain the Human Race, by Peter Fiekowsky, with Carol Douglas. Narrated by David DeBoy.
A message from the authors. Dear reader, climate change is happening today. The danger signs are all around us, and to solve the problem, we need to do more than the Paris Accord suggests. If we're honest, most of us are resigned to a future that feels bleak and inevitable. But once you read this book, you'll see that there is room for optimism. We now have ways to take CO2 and methane out of the air on an enormous scale. Climate restoration is helping nature restore itself to the conditions in which humankind has thrived for thousands of years. It's the start of a dramatic transformation that will lead to a vibrant future rather than a catastrophic one. So the volume that you are listening to is much more than a book. It's your invitation to join a community of like-minded people who understand the scientific and technological breakthroughs that can create a better future for us, our children, and our grandchildren. Learn more about the excitement of this moment and about how you can help to sustain its positive momentum by reading this book, visiting peterfiekowsky.com, and sharing the good news with friends, family, neighbors, and colleagues. A promising new era is dawning. If we act together, we can guarantee its benefits for all humankind. Yours truly, Peter Fiekowsky, Carol Douglas. More advanced praise for climate restoration. Finally, someone has done the math on our hashtag climate catastrophe in a way that gives us concrete solutions. Peter Fiekowsky offers a bold, scientifically grounded strategy that is both practical and immediately implementable. Yes, we have an enormous lift to remove the 1 trillion tons of legacy carbon in our atmosphere. Luckily, as Peter shows, there are permanent, scalable, and financeable options for achieving this. Let's stop tweeting #climateemergency and start tweeting #climaterestoration. Dr. Christopher K. Tucker, Chairman, American Geographical Society. Peter Fiekowsky's work on climate change restoration is beyond bold. It is inspired, pushes boundaries, and offers a realistic solution to the climate change crisis. It deserves a wide audience. John Englander, oceanographer, president of the Rising Seas Institute, and author of Moving to Higher Ground and High Tide on Main Street. Fiekowsky proposes what may be the most important strategy for saving the planet from climate chaos, restoring a safe climate rather than just trying to slow down our climate emissions. His logic is compelling, and his message is powerful, persuasive, and most of all, empowering. Durwood Zelke, President, Institute for Governance and Sustainable Development. Peter Fiekowsky continues to shift the climate paradigm from despair to realistic hope. Our opportunity to restore the climate is monumental, but brief, making this book both timely and essential. Rick Wayman, CEO, Foundation for Climate Restoration. In the hour when the Holy One, blessed be He, created the first person, He showed him the trees in the Garden of Eden, and said to the person, "See my works, how fine they are. Now all that I have created, I created for your benefit. Think upon this, and do not corrupt and destroy my world. For if you destroy it, there is no one to restore it after you." Ecclesiastes Rabbah 7:13. The best way to predict the future is to invent it. Alan Kay. Chapter 1. What is climate restoration? A tale of two futures. It's New Year's Day 2050. The goals set by the 2015 Paris Accords on climate change have been achieved, In just 35 years, net greenhouse gas emissions have been reduced from their peak in 2019 to zero. People celebrate with fireworks and parties across the globe. After 200 years of living with the environmental impacts of the Industrial Revolution, including 60 years of dire warnings about the threat from excessive CO2, the trend toward global warming has stabilized. The human population has also stabilized, as demographers predicted, at around 9 billion, 15% higher than in 2020. Yet, the readings from the observatory at Mauna Loa tell scientists that the global level of atmospheric CO2 is now 460 parts per million. A T-Rex would love this level, but it's 50% higher than the highest humans have lived with throughout our evolution and history. It's 67% higher than 280 parts per million, the pre-industrial average at which agriculture and the early civilizations of humankind were able to develop and flourish. The great coral reefs are gone as high water temperatures and acidity persist. The oceans are largely devoid of their once vast fish populations. Gone, too, are most of the old-growth forest and rainforest that once occupied large stretches of the planet's surface. Most were raised to grow food for the 9 billion. Some have been destroyed to provide living space for the hundreds of millions of climate refugees displaced by an average global sea level rise of about 2 feet. 2/3 of a meter. Gone, too, are the Arctic ice pack, the indigenous peoples who inhabited it, and the polar bears, sea lions, and many other species that lived in the far north. This, then, is the climate and population stability that the international community set as its goal at Paris back in 2015. It's the future you've likely heard about many times and perhaps promoted without fully understanding what it would really be like. Net zero carbon emissions mean that the rise in atmospheric CO2 has stopped, but at historically unprecedented levels. Will humanity long survive on a planet where the climate patterns that all living things have relied on for 12,000 years have been permanently changed? Where the last of the large fish and wild animals are on a path to extinction? And where human activity has taken over nearly all the land needed for diverse ecosystems? We might, but we might not. We don't know. We can't know. The path of humankind in this scenario is a risky one from which there may be no turning back. Fortunately, there is another future still available to humankind. It's New Year's Day 2050. Last month, December 2049, NASA's observatory on Mauna Loa, Hawaii, reported that atmospheric carbon dioxide has dropped back below 300 parts per million for the first time since 1910, finally returning to levels that humans have survived long term. We're back at a safe harbor, the climate range in which humanity has spent its history. We made it. The age of climate catastrophe is over. People celebrate with fireworks and parties across the globe. We have overcome the existential threat posed by runaway climate change and restored a climate that will allow humanity to survive and to flourish. To be sure, the disruption of climate by human activity has left its mark on the planet. Some peoples who inhabited island nations or the Arctic tundra have had to relocate and may never return. Some coastal regions have been flooded. We've paid a price for decades of delay. But the worst potential effects of climate change have been averted. In most regions, farmers now know when to plant again. Harvests are reliable again. The coral reefs are well on the road to full recovery. So are the fisheries on which so much of humankind depends. The hellscape of huge wildfires that once dominated the American West is a fading memory. The 1 billion men, women, and children who live in regions of Asia, Africa, and the Americas that were threatened by catastrophic flooding and who expected to become climate refugees can now remain home in safety. Extinction rates of plant and animal species have returned to their pre-industrial levels. From this vantage point, it's difficult to recall a time when the concept of climate restoration was an unfamiliar one. Decades ago, during the first half century of climate action, few in the scientific community discussed climate restoration. It wasn't until 2015 that anyone proposed it as a serious policy goal. It wasn't until 2022 that a concerted effort was launched to convince policy leaders to make it a priority. Yet now, just 28 years later, it has been accomplished. Climate change and cognitive dissonance. The first scenario described above, the one in which we achieve net zero emissions, yet still suffer unpredictable and potentially disastrous long-term impacts from climate change, is rarely invoked in the popular discourse. Yet it's all too plausible. In fact, if we stay on the current path, it's predictable. In private conversations, I've heard many scientists and other experts acknowledge the possibility of hideous social dislocations and possible extinction of the human race even if we achieve net zero emissions by 2050. But very few are willing to say so in public. Instead, nearly the entire climate community continues to publicly insist that meeting the Paris goals will avoid the worst effects of climate change. Whatever happens, we can say it could have been worse. Later in this chapter, I'll discuss some of the reasons for the gap between the public positions of most climate experts and the facts they'll acknowledge behind closed doors. But first, I want to address the skepticism you are likely feeling. If you are like most people concerned about the climate, you may be shocked and disturbed by the dire sketch painted of our vaunted zero emissions future. You may be muttering to yourself, "This can't possibly be correct." You may be tempted to dismiss my message and turn away to other activities. Confusion and denial are normal reactions to new information or views that conflict with long-held views or beliefs. If you've taken a psychology class, you may recall that psychologists call this phenomenon cognitive dissonance. It's a state of psychological distress people experience when confronted by new information that contradicts what they already know, believe, or value. It's painful to hold incompatible ideas and disturbing to face alternatives to a long-held, strongly espoused belief. People experiencing cognitive dissonance commonly do one or more of three things to relieve the pain. They attack the speaker who is delivering the message that causes the pain. They dismiss the message itself as false. Or they decide to simply stick to their previous belief without even considering the evidence for the message. I've experienced each of these three responses when I speak about the inadequacy of the Paris goals and the urgent necessity of climate restoration. Millions of us all over the world have come to recognize and care about the seriousness of the climate change threat. That's a great thing. However, some of the things we know about climate change aren't quite true. As I've already suggested, the first of these mistaken beliefs is the idea that the Paris goal of net zero carbon emissions is sufficient to solve the climate problem for humanity. I'll be offering substantive information to show why this belief is wrong, dangerously so. Of course, I'm not the only person to realize that the net zero goal doesn't go far enough to protect the future health and happiness of humankind. This is a realization that is gradually being shared by increasing numbers of thoughtful individuals. However, many of those who have begun to acknowledge the inadequacy of the Paris goals have moved on to embrace a second false belief, the idea that there is no alternative path we can take that will restore a truly healthy climate in the foreseeable future. They run the risk of succumbing to a deadly form of fatalism, assuming that net zero emissions is the best we can do, and that any vision of a better future is a mere fantasy. My message to you is that this second belief is just as flawed as the first, that there are specific concrete steps we can take that can bring about a restoration of the kind of healthy climate humankind has flourished under for 10,000 years. What's more, I will show that climate restoration is not only feasible, but once started, will pay for itself. Again, it's very possible that your reaction to this message may be one of shock, disbelief, and even anger. You may say, restoration is impossible, and ignore the data I'll offer in support of restoring the climate. If so, I suggest that you allow yourself instead to acknowledge that you are experiencing cognitive dissonance. That may give you the space to seriously consider the possible future I'm presenting. I invite you to contemplate this suggestion. After all, it's arguable that our most important job as members of the human race is to ensure the survival of our species. Hoping that we might survive with 50% higher CO2 and a population 10 times higher than the highest levels humans have survived long term is too risky. Planning and action are urgently required if we are to move from hope to science and confidence. In this book, I'll explain how we can realize the first scenario described earlier, in which climate restoration is achieved by the year 2050. I do support the protocols for reducing carbon emissions laid out in the Paris Accords, but I also contend that they are only a first step and not remotely sufficient in themselves to secure a healthy future for our species. I argue that simply following the Paris guidelines and hoping for the best is not a responsible option. There is a better goal, and the paths to achieve it are easier to implement and less costly than you might imagine. That goal is climate restoration. Its objective is to restore the safe, healthy levels of greenhouse gases last seen on Earth over a century ago and do it by 2050, while we still can. While ecosystems, political, economic, and social systems are still relatively strong, going beyond climate actions that focus on mitigating disaster, like those recommended by the Paris Accords, climate restoration will enable my children and yours and generations beyond to survive and flourish. My journey to climate restoration. A brief account of how I came to understand both the seriousness of our current climate disaster and the hopeful possibility of a climate restoration program may help you begin to overcome the cognitive dissonance that my first few remarks have likely triggered. In my career as a scientist, engineer, philanthropist, and social activist, I've long been exposed to information about the impact of a changing climate on the human environment. But for decades, I actually avoided getting involved in efforts to address the climate change dilemma. In 1975, I was an undergraduate at MIT when I first learned about global warming. I remember sitting on a sofa in the lounge one evening, reading stories about climate change in Science News and Scientific American. The message was simple. Since carbon dioxide levels in the Earth's atmosphere were rising, average temperatures across the planet were growing warmer. This was not surprising to me. Even then, it was well understood that CO2 is what we call a greenhouse gas. Like everyone else, I'd been in a greenhouse and felt its cozy warmth even on a frosty winter day. Even then, the underlying math was reasonably clear. Scientists knew that pre-industrial levels of atmospheric CO2 had been significantly lower than current levels. Recent studies continue to confirm this, pinning down the normal pre-industrial range at between 275 and 280 ppm. By 1958, when chemist Charles Keeling developed the first instrument capable of reliably measuring atmospheric CO2, the average level had already reached 318 ppm. By 1975, just 16 years later, CO2 levels had increased to 330 ppm, well beyond levels humanity had ever survived long term. In my youth, the average level rose almost 16 ppm in 16 years, about 1 ppm every year. Today, with the global population having doubled again, it's rising at twice that rate. The obvious implication of these findings was that reducing the level of new CO2 emissions into the atmosphere, for example, by transitioning away from carbon-burning fossil fuels to renewable energy, would not be sufficient to restore a fully healthy climate. Since CO2 lingers in the air for millennia, even if humankind could somehow switch over to clean energy immediately, we'd also have to pull a lot of CO2 out of the atmosphere if we hoped to return to our safe harbor level of below 300 ppm. But back in 1975, as I read those articles, I wasn't particularly alarmed. It seemed obvious to me that someone would take care of the problem of atmospheric CO2. After all, we humans had recently completed 6 successful missions to the moon, each of which had required that we solve technical problems far more complex and challenging than removing CO2 from the atmosphere. In fact, NASA improved CO2 removal technology for the mission, starting from what submarines had used for decades. What's more, the newly created Environmental Protection Agency, EPA, was then hiring chemical engineers and other experts to work on programs to remove toxic chemicals from the ground. I assumed that similar programs would be launched to get the excess CO2 out of the air in the last decades of the century, thus restoring our climate and creating a new set of scientist heroes for the world to admire and honor. Of course, this would take time, but the articles I read showed that the Earth's atmosphere was big enough to handle what we were putting into it, at least in the short term. It had been clear for 10 years that the year 2000 was a likely tipping point when the CO2 problem would start threatening human survival. That was 25 years in the future. For a teenager, the 25 years to the end of the century was a lifetime away. I remembered that President John F. Kennedy had made his famous speech challenging America to land a man on the moon in 1961, just 8 years before Neil Armstrong took his first steps on the lunar surface. It seemed reasonable that a society that could land people on the moon within 8 years could achieve the needed CO2 removal in much less than 25 years. One of the fundamental things most of us learn as infants is that adults will generally do what's needed to take care of us, even if we don't understand what's happening. That deep assumption becomes wired into our rapidly developing brains, and it remains a powerful subconscious influence on our worldview, at least until something happens to shatter it. So in 1975, as a 19-year-old, I knew without thinking about it that somebody smarter than me, the adult in the room, would take care of the CO2 problem. So I stayed out of the way. I continued to pursue my major in astrophysics, enjoying the challenges of studying the chemistry and physics of a galaxy called M87, 50 million light years away. And I put the problems of climate change here on planet Earth out of my mind. To leave our children a world we're proud of. After graduation, I worked in astrophysics at NASA, then on improving semiconductor manufacturing at an artificial intelligence, AI, lab. Later, I started my business, automated visual inspection, based on some advances I made in AI and machine vision. At the same time, I became deeply involved in volunteer work and poverty reduction with a citizen advocacy organization called Results. Results was taking on seemingly impossible goals and meeting them one after another. Although at the time I was too naive to appreciate how impossible they really were. For instance, UNICEF had promised in the 70s to vaccinate all the world's children by 1990. By 1985, more regions were getting vaccinated, but the global vaccination rate was still below half, with no way in sight to achieve UNICEF's goal. Results got involved. We convinced Congress to provide the funding that made it possible to raise the child immunization rate to 85%, short of the 100% promised, but enough to profoundly change the world. That rate held steady for 30 years until a slight dip during the COVID pandemic. Another cause led by results was microcredit, the ingenious financial tool developed by Nobel Prize winner Muhammad Yunus, which empowers people to lift themselves out of poverty through small loans designed to help them start or expand businesses. Sam Daly Harris, the leader of Results, helped launch the Microcredit Summit organization, which set the goal of providing access to microcredit for half of the world's poorest people, 500 million people, and to do it within 10 years. Technically, we fell short. It took 11 years to reach the 500 million mark. Again, Results helped to profoundly change the world. Yet another example. In the 2000s, Results helped organize campaigns that convinced international policymakers to fund treatment for tens of millions of people living with HIV/AIDS. This effort played a major role in turning around an epidemic that had taken millions of lives, terrified countless more, and had seemed insurmountable for nearly two decades. Those campaigns taught me the power of setting a specific, ambitious target for any important project. As I tell the people I work with, if your goal is so vague that you can't fail, if you promise simply to try, then you can't succeed. If you wish to accomplish something important, then you need to risk failure. And as the child immunization program shows, if you keep playing, even failure can yield huge successes. Today, I have a sticky note on my computer monitor that says, "Whatever you make doable ends up being done." Making it doable means having a specific, measurable goal and specific milestones that take you there. A meaningful mission statement that serves as a North Star is also an invaluable tool for those who want to make a real difference. While working with Results on the HIV/AIDS challenge, I created my personal mission statement: to leave our children a world we're proud of. For the last 20 years, I've selected the projects I engage in based on whether or not they are critical to that mission. What is our climate goal? Around 2010, I noticed that our progress in reducing hunger and poverty was faltering after 40 years of remarkable gains. I realized that two factors were driving this trend: population and global warming. The famous 1972 report, Limits to Growth, commissioned by a quasi-governmental organization called the Club of Rome, had pointed out that, on the then-current path of population growth, economic expansion, and increasing pollution, sometime around the year 2000, things would start collapsing. Big things like ecosystems, economies, and societies. Like many of my contemporaries, I found the study highly convincing, even obvious. It seemed to me self-evident that uncontrolled exploitation of natural resources driven by unlimited population growth could only lead to environmental calamity. By 2010, the worsening trends I perceived largely reflected the kind of resource shortage disaster that Limits to Growth had predicted. But climate change, which had also not figured in the Club of Rome's calculations, was also playing a part. It was making growing seasons more erratic and food harder to produce. It was exacerbating disasters like droughts, floods, and hurricanes, and making portions of the planet unlivable. Shorelines were changing. Coral reefs were dying. Meanwhile, the human population had doubled again between 1975 and 2010, exacerbating conflicts over water and other resources. In fact, the world's population, which had remained largely stable for eons prior to industrialization, had soared tenfold from about 700 million in 1700 to more than 7 billion. Together, climate change and the vast scale of human impact were threatening the collapse of ecosystems and climate systems worldwide. I realized that on the world's current course, my personal goal was likely to go unmet, along with the goals of billions of other people from every walk of life. One outgrowth of that realization was my decision to get involved in addressing the issue of climate change. It appeared that no collection of adults in the room, in government or anywhere else, had taken it upon themselves to solve it. I was not the only results volunteer with that insight. A couple of years earlier, Marshall Saunders, a real estate developer in San Diego and a good friend and protege of mine at Results, had established the Citizens Climate Lobby, CCL. His intention was to produce the same kind of world-changing impacts in climate that Results had helped achieve in poverty and hunger. I was delighted that finally, after 45 years, someone was really taking on climate change in a meaningful way. I became a supporter of CCL. But after 3 years, with the number of CCL members having grown from 2 people to 200, I got the sense that no real impact was being made. So I got more involved. I asked my friend Mark Reynolds, the executive director of CCL, "What is the goal of CCL and the climate movement? What are you using as a specific measurable target? And what's your deadline for achieving it?" Mark thought about this query, and rather than make up an answer, he said, "Good question, Peter. That's your job now. Talk with Dr. James Hansen, who's on our board. Figure out the answer and report it to us." Dr. Hansen is a physicist and a former director of NASA's Goddard Institute. Shortly thereafter, he and I had lunch, and I posed the same question I'd asked Mark. I was floored when he said simply, "I don't know." Hansen went on to explain that although the essential physics of climate change was clear, despite hard efforts by CCL and other organizations, there appeared to be no chance that Congress or the President would take effective action to address the problem. The best future he could imagine was that we might get CO2 back to 350 ppm by the end of the century. By 2010, the average level was approaching 390. I was disturbed by this answer. Referring to his 2008 paper, I asked, "Dr. Hansen, 350 ppm would be a likely death sentence for humanity, wouldn't it?" He confirmed that it would. "But if we actually got there," he said, "we could see where to go next." My instincts, honed through my business career and my years as a volunteer activist, kicked in. I don't get involved in companies or projects that aren't designed to succeed. For a time, I abandoned climate again, putting my focus on expanding Results health and poverty work into Africa. But the next spring, my daughter came home from college, brimming with excitement over the things she was accomplishing, proud of achievements at school, and overflowing with plans for the future. Was I willing to fail her? How could I leave her, her brother, and everyone else's children a world in which humanity might not survive rather than one we can be proud of? That was the moment when I finally committed to the concept of climate restoration. I didn't relish the idea of having to convince experts like Dr. Hansen to join me, but I realized that someone had to take on this challenge. I went on to create the Foundation for Climate Restoration, and to launch the large-scale education and lobbying effort of which the book you are reading represents a part. Today's Inconvenient Truth. When we look at the universe of climate activists, including concerned scientists, government officials, and engaged citizens, their overwhelming goal has been and continues to be the reduction of carbon dioxide emissions. Today, specifically, the almost universal goal is to reduce emissions to net zero by 2050. Net zero means that whatever CO2 human activity continues to emit will compensate for it by withdrawing that amount of CO2 somewhere else. There's a widespread impression that the net zero emission goal is an explicit commitment found in the Paris Climate Accords. That's not quite correct. The actual objective stated in the agreement, Article 2, Paragraph 1A, is holding the increase in the global average temperature to well below 2 degrees Celsius above pre-industrial levels and pursuing efforts to limit the temperature increase to 1.5 degrees Celsius above pre-industrial levels. Elsewhere in the agreement, Article 4, Paragraph 1, it is stated that the parties aim to achieve a balance between anthropogenic emissions by sources and removals by sinks of greenhouse gases in the second half of the century as a way of achieving the temperature goal. This is another way of saying net zero emissions by 2050. Thus, the actual Paris goal is to limit global warming. The means of pursuing that goal include net zero emissions. It's a subtle but important distinction. Many countries, provinces, and cities have adopted net zero as a goal, but no such goal is explicitly mandated in the Paris Accords. At net zero, which is also sometimes called the drawdown point, CO2 levels will be stable. The climate will stop warming, the oceans will stop getting more acidic, and storms will probably stop getting worse. There's also a chance that, in accordance with the Paris goals, the increase in average global temperature levels can be kept below 2 degrees Celsius, perhaps even below 1.5 degrees. There is an understandable historic reason for the net zero goal. 50 years ago, when global warming started getting attention, achieving net zero would have kept our planet livable. Unfortunately, we have held to that goal almost like a religious dogma, even as the world has changed radically. In that time, the world's population has doubled yet again. In the same period, CO2 has gone from arguably safe levels to levels that are warming the planet rapidly, and thus pose an unpredictable and unprecedented risk to human survival, and our ecosystems are collapsing before our eyes. Evidence from the daily headlines even suggests that our political and social systems may be collapsing in synchrony under the environmental pressures that climate change is producing. It's time to acknowledge the inconvenient truth that climate scientists and activists have failed to confront. Meeting the goal of net zero by 2050 in no way guarantees the survival of human society as we know it, or even that of Homo sapiens as a species. This reality is acknowledged by the scientific community, not expressly, but by its silence. No scientist I know will publicly affirm that achieving the goals set by the Paris Accords will provide humanity with a flourishing future, or even with a clear path to survival. Thus, we can reshape the world economy to achieve net zero, we can make a complete transition to renewable energy, with the electric grid largely running off solar, wind, and batteries, we can make all our vehicles run on electricity, we can completely eliminate fossil fuels and stop destroying forests tomorrow, but the ecosystems we depend on will still continue to collapse. That's because, even without further carbon emissions, there will still be a trillion tons, that is 1,000 billion tons, of excess CO2 lingering in the atmosphere for a millennium or longer. As I'll explain a little later, some other greenhouse gases, such as methane, play a lesser but meaningful contributory role in the crisis we are now facing. Therefore, the climate will not significantly improve for centuries or millennia, even once the net zero goal is reached. The ice caps will continue to melt, and sea levels will continue to rise, likely displacing hundreds of millions of people, while ecosystems continue to collapse. The Paris Accords and other climate agreements were designed to limit the worst effects of climate change, or as some have written, to avoid a climate disaster. William Nordhaus, the Nobel Prize-winning economist who helped define the goal of limiting global warming to 2 degrees Celsius in 1977, selected this target because he considered it the level most likely to maximize economic growth, as measured by global GDP, even in the face of agricultural decline due to rising temperatures. Nordhaus was not applying the perspective of a physical scientist or an environmental expert. nor did he address the broader goal of human thriving. As befits an economist, his focus was on GDP growth. It's also important to note that Nordhaus did not have access to today's data about the impact of CO2 emissions. As far as he knew, the long-term warming we faced would be a quarter of what history now tells us. We've collectively put our faith and energy into achieving the 1980 era target of net zero, failing to face the reality that net zero is now woefully inadequate.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.